So we're going to start with, how should we interpret the Adam and Eve story in light of modern science? And basically the intention here is to have like a 50-50 dialogue. So, Dennis, do you believe that there was really a historical person named Adam and Eve?
Yeah.
Okay, now, so, and you don't accept modern, so let me just say this. In modern evolutionary theory, there is no such thing as a first human or a first rabbit or a first anything, because all species evolve over time and within a population. So there's never a first of anything. There's a gene pool and all that. But you don't accept evolution, right?
So, right.
So how do you... So basically, why don't you just briefly tell me what your position is on Adam and Eve then? You believe that basically God just made them? How did God make Adam and Eve?
Well, just the way it says in the Bible. I mean, obviously neither of us was there. We don't have any video footage or anything. So so what we have to go on is basically science and the Bible. And when I say the Bible, I don't mean to just blindly accept it. I mean, I wrote a book called The Proof, and then that God exists in the Bible is true. And so I've heavily studied that, you know, the Bible can be backed up as a book of truth, both from the science standpoint and from many other viewpoints, actually. So so I guess what it comes down to is we have a choice, you know, as to whether to accept evolution, the theory of evolution, or not, or the Bible. And, you know, being that I found that science actually backs the Bible and not evolution, because, you know, like, for instance, there are millions of fossils, and yet there aren't any transitional forms. They can't be disproven as either being a hoax or, you know, or unscientific. So, like, you know, animals, in other words, that they're calling man forms that are really animals. So so that leaves me with two options as far as, like, you know, what to decide. And so being that science is not on the side of evolution, and science is on the side of the Bible, then science and logic would say that I should abandon the theory of evolution until some proof comes along. You know, in the meantime, the evidence in the book, The Proof, shows that there is a lot of proof that the Bible and its accounts of origins are true.
Okay, well, let's back up a little bit. So one thing I hope we can talk about is, you said there's no evidence for evolution, and I would say one evidence I think is extremely compelling is what they call genomic evidence, the evidence in the DNA. But I want to back up and we could talk about that, but I want to back up again. So you said you believe that in the first humans as the Bible portrays it. So the Bible literally says that God scooped dirt or the mud or whatever and formed man and then breathed life into it. So do you think that's literally how it happened? Like, in other words, if you had a videotape at that time, that's what you would have actually seen and the way it's recorded?
Right. I mean, that's not a preposterous thing to envision or think, because, I mean, what about the universe, physical universe itself was created? That's a miracle right there. So, you know, why couldn't God do it any way that he wanted to?
So what about all the other animals, like, for example, a whale, for example? Do you think God basically made that like a poof, you know, there was no whale and all of a sudden there was a whale, kind of a poof kind of thing?
Right.
So basically the animals kind of poofed into existence, all the animals?
Yes, a poof.
Okay. Now, what would you say about... I guess in my opinion, most Christians would disagree with that. What do you think?
Oh, no, I don't think so. I think just the opposite. There's no reason really to take the Bible other than literal. I mean, if you're going to be into the Bible.
What do you think about, like, William Lane Craig, for example? He's like one of the most famous Christian debaters, and, you know, he would definitely not go for this, you know, proof, you know?
Well, then he's not into the Bible. It's that simple.
Okay, so like maybe Ken Ham might agree with you, and he's actually a young Earth creationist. So your view would be like with Ken Ham?
I wouldn't say exactly what he does, because there's just some things that I disagree that he does. But
just on human origins, it would be the same, pretty much, that you think?
Yeah, he believes it, but you know, I have proof backing it up more so than him. He starts with a biblical worldview. That's what he says. You either start with a biblical worldview or a naturalistic worldview. Mm. And but I say no, you can't just start there. You have to bridge the gap between logic and science to get to that point.
Okay, now you say there is no evidence at all for evolution, but you know, we've had numerous debates and things, and I always bring up there is a lot of evidence. There's genomic evidence, but that always seems to kind of roll off. You just roll
well, go,
right
go
off.
Ahead,
of you. You don't
go ahead and state restate your proof there.
Well, one of the most famous arguments, I guess, are pseudogenes, where we have it's obvious that we have inherited broken genes that, you know, that other animals, according to descent, have, and we have busted copies.
I'm still not tracking with that. So.
Well, the pseudogene argument. So you're not familiar with the pseudogene argument, then?
No. I know about the genome, but go ahead.
Okay, so basically, if you compare all the animals across, for example, all mammals, and for example, one would be the insulin gene. Well, that's not the pseudogene argument. That's just similarity. So basically, the vitamin C one is one, ascorbic acid, where we cannot synthesize vitamin C, where other mammals can. And according to descent, and you can see where we actually have, the reason why we can't is because our gene is chopped up and it's not functional. And this is why we have to eat vitamin C or we get scurvy. But some other mammals do have it. And we can see, for example, that, you know, like us and the gorillas, the gorillas, for example, yeah, they have the same, I can't remember if they have the same problem or not, but at some point, like dogs and cats, you know, they don't have this problem. And so if you look at evolutionary trees and see where we came from, you can see that those, according to descent, they have the gene that works. And we have thousands and thousands of busted genes. For example, in the olfactory sense, our sense of smelling, we have all these smelling genes for smelling, you know, detecting odors, but they're busted. And, you know, other animals, like dogs, for example, they're not busted with them.
Well, I mean, there's a lot of differences between us and animals, and there's a lot of things that animals can do that we can't do. You know, chameleons could change colors. Dogs have to live, you know, in the wild. They have to live off of things that we couldn't live off of, and they have to process them. So they need, you know, extra abilities.
But according to this argument, if you have an evolutionary tree of descent, and what you can see is, you can see the pattern of how an ancestor has genes that work, and the descendants gradually drop those genes. And the genes are dropped according to descent. And so the farther along descent, the more genes are dropped. So there's a sequential progression of broken genes. And so if there is no descent, then it's like, you know, if God really did create people individually, then it's like he misled scientists to plant the evidence to make it look like there was a descent. So what I'm saying is, you can tell as the descent happens, the genes get more and more busted.
Well, you know, that's one way of looking at it. I don't think that's the case. Like I said, animals have needs, you know, as far as like processing food and stuff like that, that we don't have. Mm. And so that's the reason we don't need them.
Okay, so we have about one more minute. What would you like to finish up on this topic about Adam and Eve?
Let's see. Well, I guess there's nothing really more to say. You know, I mean, you know, regarding evolution, you know, Darwin even called this theory of evolution the devil's gospel. So he knew what he was getting into there. And he also said if he knew what we knew now that he wouldn't have put forth that theory. It's got to remember, it's a theory.
Okay, so scientific theory, though, is different than somebody just saying, I have a theory. A scientific theory entails a whole bunch of laws and facts and bundles them all together for a theory. So it's not just a theory like somebody has a hunch kind of theory. It's a scientific theory, which is different than a person's opinion.
Right, know? I agree.
So, like, people, when they say it's just a theory, they're usually misrepresenting what a scientific theory is.
Let me say one other thing, too, about because I did prove the Bible, is the Bible's standpoint that there was a first man and a first woman, you know, and there was no death before that. God's initial intention was that humans would live as humans forever. So if there was evolution, well, then there had to be death mm-hmm. before the Bible, the way the Bible says.
Right. Right, and some people have said, too, that, well, the original creation had to include death, otherwise the original creation wouldn't have been good. It said God created creation, and before it fell, he said it was good, but it wouldn't be good unless it was sustainable. And if there was no death, it wouldn't be sustainable because creatures would be reproducing and there would be no room to hold everything.
Well, he did say, though, to just replenish the earth. You know, as it turned mm-hmm. out, there death came into existence, but... The original intention wasn't there.
Okay, well, that's the complaint, though. If it's not in the original design, then it wouldn't have been sustainable.
Yeah, I don't think so, because, like, for instance, you know, there's always a complaint about overpopulation in the world. Yet if you do the math, say my house is 1,132 square feet. So if you do the math, you can give 1,132 square feet to 7 billion people, and it would all fit in the state of Texas. So that's pretty sustainable.
Okay, well, we got to leave it on there because we're out of time on this one. So let's go to the next one. And this next one might be...